It's not that you cannot do sex. Again, as I already developed, I think, in the Plague of Fantasies, the true mystery for me and the proof of my point. It's not so much that you cannot have real sex in a serious melodrama or drama where you are supposed to identify. What interests me more is the opposite experience, a hardcore film with its, for me, most mysterious property, which is how totally stupid, unbelievably stupid the narrative is. You know, you have to introduce the act, no? And I love them. They are so vulgar, but they are stupid. Like, you remember, I saw recently one, I admit it, when, you know, the housewife alone at home, a plumber comes and fixes the, and the housewife says, sorry, but I have another hole to fix. Could you maybe, you know, you are embarrassed. No, I think this is objectively necessary. They cannot be that stupid, the producers. It's as if you can have real sex, but you have to pay the price in the stupidity of the narrative. And I think that at some level this gap is maintained. Don't have time, I'm sorry, to develop it now. Now, hegemony and so on and so on. What I would say that nonetheless with Ernesto and Chantal, the problem is a different one. I mean, okay, he's still mad at me after for that triple orgy book, Hegemony and so on. But let me say a bad thing and a good thing. First bad news, then good news. Although it will be more at the level of that one, you know, like, first the bad news, you have Alzheimer's. The good news, you have Alzheimer's. You will forget about it when you come home, no? I mean, okay, no, the bad news. My problem is with radical democracy, but what it is, more than, like, why should not Blair claim that he is a radical Democrat? All their analysis does not convince me. It means, okay, multiple subjectivities, non-essentialism, and so on and so on. But I'll put it in another way. I don't see any specific use for today's politics from the theory of radical democracy. I think it just have a kind of a tautological message. The message is the same as, you know, you go to a doctor and you ask him, what should I do? And the doctor tells you, Go to a doctor and take a medical advice or whatever, you know. Like, I don't see how it is politically operative. I don't have time to develop this now. Let me nonetheless turn to a good thing, which is, I think, the notion of class of antagonism, which I think is useful today to be emphasized. In what sense? Here, I will defend myself against Laclau with his term, in his terms, very short. My problem, why I still like to refer to class struggle, it doesn't have to do anything with some kind of substantial social content, naive essentialism. The whole space is different. For me, the key difference between what we once called class struggle and all these struggles from recognition, the way they function today, usually the ethnic tolerance struggle, sexual minority struggle, is what? To put it in a very blunt way, although we also have an enemy, sexist, racist, but nonetheless, the fundamental horizon of, let's say, ethnic struggle, is there is a multitude of groups and antagonism should be translated into peaceful coexistence of differences. It's not us against them, Indians, Turks, whatever. It is open space where all the flowers can thrive. You know, President Mao, let the 100 flowers thrive. I always liked what people don't like to remind, but then he added on condition that they are all red, but that's another story, no? What I'm saying is that, but wait a minute, the very logic of class struggle is different. There, the point is not bourgeois and proletarians, they should try to recognize each other, live in a, no, recognize, it's on the contrary, it's struggle to death, it's antagonism. The horizon there is not to translate antagonism into difference, but on the contrary, to translate difference into antagonism. That is to say, against the organicist notion, we are here workers, there are managers, there are capitalists, let's go all together and articulate our difference. No, it's fight, it's different. Here, I think, nonetheless, a legacy should be kept for, that we should bear in mind that there is a logic of antagonism, of struggle, which cannot be contained in the frame of multitude of differences, toleration of differences. I was extremely short for me, for my notes.
Thank you. You just said.
It's A couple of points again on the things you're saying about Simon Critchley. I do agree with the criticisms you made, but there's a slight point when you start talking about searching for an eventual site, looking for where this sort of revolution is possible today. This word search, there are different ways of approaching it, and I think one way quite often appears is if you're kind of gazing at the political field as if from afar, and you know, the idea that if you stare ever so intently at it, you know, you might just see someone waving a red flag in one corner and there's the eventual site. I don't think it works like that. I don't think it's enough to really say, oh, you know, here are these slum delves, we should watch them to see if they do anything interesting. I think that search that you're looking for is a far more interventionary thing. I mean, it's like, I don't know, if I'm searching for a pair of clean socks in my bedroom's a mess afterwards. I have to pick things up and throw them around a bit. So there's a nuance there I think is worth looking at.
Maybe I should verify. Let me just tell you that I, you know, quite honest, without any irony, self-criticism, I totally agree with you. That is to say, I would even, you know, like that famous phrase of statement by Picasso that Lacan often refers to, Picasso said, I don't search, I find. I agree with you. It's not, because this is what Stalin's notion. No, you look around, you see, they are the potentially winning horse, so let's support the proletarians. No, I totally agree with you. I should have to put it, it's not that we search for it, we should be found by them, how to put it. I agree. You see, I was too short. Quite seriously, you know where is my basic problem here? Now I will say something that probably you will disagree. You know, this fundamental impulse, the system is oppressing us, let's explode, let's liberate ourselves. I mistrust it. I think that if you put this position in an abstract way, it's already hegemonized. It more serves the system. I don't believe that this, how should I call it, liberating attitude of let's just, you know, let your steam free or whatever. That is to say, the notion of a system as an oppressive power, and then we have to break the chains, explode, and so on. I think it doesn't work. I think that, the standard term, that the system, whatever it means, itself is already to such an extent not only manipulating, but directly soliciting, needing, generating all kinds of transgressions and so on and so on. No, here I'm much more of a pessimist, and I even think along the same lines that all these other struggles that we like so much, like feminist and so on and so on. Now I will again say something horrible. I don't think that all these struggles are automatically on our side. I can well imagine a situation, and I don't only imagine it, I think it exists today in the United States, where I think that feminist movement is 50-50.